Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today for the Economic Times live webinar on the topic Enhancing Business Operations with Hyper Automation Enabled Digital Transformation. The session is powered by Datamatics, an IBM partner. I am Dimple Bajwa from ETH, welcoming you all to this session. Technology lies at the heart of any digital transformation. It is the integration of digital technology into all elements of a business, fundamentally altering how you operate and deliver value to customers. It's also a cultural shift that requires organizations to constantly challenge the status quo, experiment, and learn to accept failure. When it comes to digital transformation, there is a case to be made for business and financial prudence. To make their business processes more agile, companies have begun to move beyond process automation. They are now into hyper-automation. IT leaders are now concentrating on quick fixes to improve business processes, yet finding the right technology for the right process remains a challenge. Hyper-automation is presently attracting a lot of attention owing to the numerous advantages and business benefits it brings to the table. The speakers in today's session will address how digital transformation is a business enabler, with delivering value being the primary driver. The points that will be touched upon during the session are how organizations across industries set their digital transformation vision, how organizations are leveraging hyper-automation to achieve their digital transformation vision, and industry best practices for successful digital transformation with industry use cases from experts. And to shed more light on the same, we have a power-packed panel lined up with us today. We have Satyaki Raghunath, Chief Strategy and Development Officer, BLR Airport; Deepak Mudalgikar, Chief Technology Officer, SBFC Finance; Monojeet Paul, General Manager, E-Commerce and Digital Initiatives, State Bank of India; Tapan Mehta, APAC Head, Data, AI and Automation Ecosystems, IBM. And the session will be moderated by Sachin Range, EVP and Head, Software Solutions, Datamatics. The audience can post their questions in the Q&A or the chat window. We will try to bring them up towards the end of this session. And now, without further ado, I invite Sachin to take it from here. Over to you, Sachin.
Yes. Thank you, Dimple. Good introduction, and good morning once again to the panel, as well as the people who joined us, taken their precious time. I'm sure the time will be worth, because we got a good esteemed panel here. You know, we try to bring out the practitioner's view here, because the panel that you see here, they have a kind of experience or digital transformation. We keep hearing this word, digital transformation, hyper automation. But in practical sense, you know, what it makes, you know, what it makes to implement a successful digital transformation. I think that is what endeavor would be, to bring out that perspective from the panelists here. So my name is Sachin, and I'll basically attempt doing that in next 45 to 50 minutes. After that, we'll take some questions. So there are, if you look at the theme of today's discussion, there are two keywords that we're talking about. One is hyper automation, and second is digital transformation. So I will perhaps, you know, spend a minute on hyper automation. So hyper automation, in simple words, in my own definition, is basically you maximize the automation in your organization, basically to do maximize the business process as well as, you know, IT processes, automate them to the maximum possible extent. And there are technologies that can be orchestrated together, technology like robotic process automation, technology like AI, technologies like digital scanning, indexing. So all that you put together, and then you know, create orchestration that will help you to automate the business processes in your organization. And hyper automation basically enables you to do that. So there is a linkage of hyper automation and digital transformation. Basically, it helps a digital transformation initiative in an organization. So that is what we'll try and establish to understand both in this discussion. So I think I will bring Satyaki in this organ, you know, in the discussion, to first define how we see the digital transformation, I'm aware that, you know, Bangalore International Airport, the organization that this is part of, has done it very successfully, and they actually the journey continues. So Satyaki, maybe just want to share about, you know, your definition, and then what has digital transformation, you know, helped, you know, organization, what was prior scenario and what is current. And obviously I understand it's a journey, but maybe just throw some lights on that.
Thank you, Sachin. Thank you to ET for inviting me to be part of this very exciting and interesting panel. I think from our perspective at Bangalore Airport, as I suspect for most other enterprises, digital transformation is how we use, or the process of using technology, and in this case, digital technology, to think about our business in a new way, in terms of how can we sort of modify existing processes, culture, customer experience, operational efficiency, and things like that. And how do we do it better, given sort of the growing traffic needs, changing customer preferences, hyper-personalization, what the business is looking for, and the fact that at the end of the day, we can't build our way out of the problem as we used to in the past. And I think especially in an airport context, as you all know, there are huge, for a very, very significant proportion of fixed costs, given the fact that whether we have a single operation or whether we have 200,000 operations, we still need a runway. So it's not as if I can sort of build less of a runway just because I have, say, 10 operations a day. Right? We still have to have the runway, take the aircraft. So historically, airports have been organizations or enterprises with very large fixed costs. And as traffic grew, especially in that period between 2008, when Bangalore Airport was commissioned, through 2015, 16, 17, even though we had a couple of blips along the way with the collapse of Kingfisher, with the market slowing down with the financial crisis and things like that, I think traffic kept recovering very, very fast and outperformed most of our projections. So when we celebrated our 10th anniversary in 2018, we had tripled the traffic volumes from when the airport opened. So we had opened the first year with about 9 million passengers. And when we celebrated our 10th anniversary, we had just actually served 27 million passengers for the year. And based on our forecasts, and the master plan update that we were doing at that point, we were pretty confident that by 2030 or thereabouts, we will triple once again in traffic volume to be at about 80 million annual passengers. And to put that in some context, that's sort of the size of Heathrow or Dubai or Chicago Air, etc. So when you look at those volumes, we also realize that we could constantly only think of CapEx or building our way out of the problem. And we had to think of a different way of our business in terms of how we could operate from the perspectives of significantly enhancing customer experience, thinking about operational efficiency and how we could do more with less. And finally, how do we also use technology to think about how we can generate revenue in new ways? And I think those were the three key drivers from our perspective for our digital transformation journey. And that's what we focused on over the course of the last, I would say, 4 or 5 years. And in many ways, COVID has done more for sort of acceleration of digital transformation than almost anything else, because we've sort of had to adapt to what I suppose everybody calls the new normal or whatever, all these cliched terms. But at the end of the day, I think COVID has certainly accelerated our adoption. It's accelerated cultural transformation, and it certainly made digital transformation far easier in terms of how organizations need to go with it. And I think it's become an imperative now, not just for us, but I suppose for most organizations that are of any sort of size or scale.
Sure, Satyaki, thanks. So I think I pick up two, three key points from your, what you said just now. I think CapEx, then operational efficiency, and digital experience, I think that these are something which are rather customer experience. That these are three keywords I picked up from what you said. I think these are the some things that the digital transformation has helped you to achieve these, at least. And I'm sure the journey is continuing, but I think these are the three things I think from your perspective that has helped Bangalore Airport, right? Yeah. Thanks, Satyaki. And obviously, we'll be happy to be part. Datamatics and IBM both are your partners. So happy to be part of this journey along with you. Thank you so much. So I will now go to Manojit. Manojit, we keep hearing about SBI's digital transformation, and we I'm sure, you know, you talk about your apps. I will not dwell too much about that, but we want to hear from you as to what's your journey has been in beginning your organization on digital transformation. And the second follow-up question is, any transformation will bring some changes, right? So it's a change management process. And Satyaki, I think just spoke, touched upon it. Maybe you just want to talk about, you know, the change management aspect of any transformation that has happened in SBI. So over to you, Manoj.
Okay, thanks. See, for the State Bank of India, it is a very old organization, you all know. So evolving from the 19th century route, today SBI is at the forefront of the country's digital transformation. And this has been possible for us because digital transformation was taken as a response to the changes which were happening in the BFSI environment. In fact, internally, we say that we aspire to live like dinosaur and not to extinct like dinosaur. So, and the journey has started long back. You know, we have started the journey in 1997 with a branch computation initiative. So those are the days when the manual things were transformed to computation. And till today, we have our current flagship product, which is UNO. And being the largest bank of the country, our digital transformation means we have to go hand in hand with the government of India's vision of making the digital India, making a cashless society. And at the same time, for our survival also, means to compete efficiently as a business, to satisfying the stakeholders, the digital initiative is a must for us. So when we have taken the digital initiative, we have taken care of both the internal customer, that is our staff, as well as the external customer. And for external customer, naturally the focus was, to give a next generation customer experience by digitization, simplification of the journey by reimagining the process, and to give a digital bank experience. And through it was our flagship product where we have experimented another thing, that let us provide a single platform for all customer needs, the banking, investment, lifestyle, so that the customer can use a single platform. That's why the name was given as You Only Need One. And for our staff, the focus was that, we have all these legacy manual processes. So those things have to be digitized end to end. So now just to, take it forward, that what we have achieved now, see SBI, we have 48 crores customer. Out of these 48 customers, if we remove this, low frail account, etc., we have 28 crore customers who are eligible to offer as a digital services. So out of which, we could achieve only around 8 crores. So there's a long way to go. And in we have achieved 4.2 crore registrations. The platform has adopted well. We are witnessing more than 1 crore login per day, 10 lakhs transaction per day. The digital initiative also helped us to increase our productivity, to reduce the cost to income ratio, which was one of our objective. There's a different experience of executing the project as an agile method, because as a public sector organization, we are following the traditional waterfall method, paper process, etc. In we have experimented that agile method of working, where it was a garage mode, there was a co-creation happened, and we are getting the result also. Say, for example, if I share 2-3 figures, like in August itself, we have booked 3,400 crores PAPL. So this digital lending book that is growing, onboarding also is possible. We have done 7 lakh savings bank account opening. We have introduced the video KYC. We are doing the cross-selling of the business, etc. And there is one more thing I would like to share, is that our digital transmission, it has helped us to move from branch channel to digital channel. See, I can share you the figure. Before pandemic, we were handling 20% transaction through branches and 80% were happening through alternate channel. But in the last month figure, only 7% transactions are happening now through branch. Okay. And these changes, in the customer behavior, this adoption, it is permanent. Because as a customer, if they get the taste of digital, it is very difficult for them to go back to the traditional system of the manual bank, etc. Now, just to taking up the second part of your question, yes, change is always painful. And in an organization like State Bank of India, which is so huge, the customer base is so huge, to bring that changes, to adopt the changes by these huge people, it is always a challenging task.
Absolutely.
But at the same time, we have done some preparation, like for customer education, if you go to the branch, we have the Tech Mitra concept, we have Graph Mitra concept, and because this digital transformation also has coming up with the risks of digital frauds. You might be aware that there's a parallel industry which is working to deceive the customers. They are, you know, finding always the new ways. So we, you know, embrace on this customer education, what is to be done, what is not to be done, do and don't, etc. And for an internal staff, now we have 17 different circles. We have gone through a model where we have identified the change leaders from each circle. These change leaders, we have our State Bank Learning Department at each circle. These change leaders are coordinated with the learning center where we arrange training for our staff. We have the online, arrange online quizzes. We have distributed videos. And we have given the business care also, so that these change agents and these change are adopted well by our staff. Because they are actually our, you know, frontline, player who actually pass on this information and disseminate it to the customer. So that's how we are, managing it.
Yeah, thank you, Monujit. I think I'm on the other side of, from a SBI perspective, I'm one of your happy customers. So thank you for that digital initiative. All you need one, that app, I think it's good. So I think from an end user point of view, we are one of our happy customers. So thank you for that initiative. I think digital initiatives actually has helped the lives of ordinary customers like me from a bank perspective. Thank you once again. And
nice to hear. Thank you.
So let me bring Deepak here. Deepak, we talk about, I defined hyper automation, and everybody talks about hyper automation in a big way. So can you define, one is obviously you may want to share your experiences on digital transformation within SBFC Finance, and you being one of the finest CTO in the country today, what technology like hyper automation has helped in your organization? Maybe you just want to share your experiences.
Hi, good morning everyone, and thanks CT and Sachin for this beautiful opportunity with the extreme panelists. So first of all, let me just brief about SBFC. We call ourselves as a 4-year-old company with prior 8 years legacy. What I mean by this is basically, it was a Karvy Financial Services, which we have taken over. And last 4 years, we have done a good journey in improving all the internal processes and the applications. So earlier, when we took over, Karvy had everything through the paper processing. So we have come from that stage to the stage right now. So when I took over, the first thing I had to do was, like even as Manojit sir mentioned, we have two sets of customers, internal customers as well as the external customers. So first thing we thought that let's make the life simpler for the internal customers. So earlier, the paper movement which used to happen, file movements which used to happen, I had to stop that. The first thing I did was basically, introduce the complete state-of-the-art origination system for the customers, where it not only gave the instant gratification to my internal customers, who are my end users, who are the sales officers on the floor, on the street, plus the customer, because we had integrations with all the external agencies so that the immediate decisioning can be made whether it's a go or no go. Basis that, then my internal customer can go for the further processing. That gave a first wow to them. And that's, once we created that, then I went ahead and created a complete customer mobile app, which gives the customer the power in his hand for self-servicing. Any requests earlier, they had to come to the branches. Renewals, they had to come to the branches, which we took care of them through the apps. So just let me tell you another thing. We are an NBFC. We are into the business of lending against properties, lending against gold. And you know the gold, the way the business is. We call ourselves as a digital model, a physical plus digital model. And we would like to continue with that, as we primarily believe that we are not in the business of lending, but we are in the business of collection. And that's why we need to understand our customer very well. So keeping that external customer in mind, we did these kind of changes for them. And then, another thing we did is that digital way, we have created a complete digital journey for customer, where we had 70 plus APIs introduced in that journey, where again, a decisioning was done through the artificial intelligence. That's where a quick decision, immediate decisioning that can be done then and there itself for the customer while he's on the website and the loan gets dispersed to him immediately. In my prior organization, I had done a couple of those challenges where, you know, projects where I had done the 10-second loan dispersal of the loan in 10 seconds. The similar kind of a methodology I implemented here, did the bucketing and implemented the, you know, complete artificial intelligence in the background, the Angular enterprise rule engine, so that we can have a right product, a right amount dispersed to the right customer within no time. And depending on the customer profile, then that bucketing changes and the time definitely tight increases. Another thing we did while doing all these things at the back end, we were improving the entire operational efficiency. Though the paper movement was not there, the files were not there, but still there was a data entry, there were the things which had to be done by the operational end. We implemented the process automation there, which basically helped with the help of bots where we could do the, you know, improve that tat over there also, because the volume started growing. We definitely couldn't continue with the manual process and we had to do the automation. So that was one thing. The another thing which we did last year, a very important thing, we call it as a reverse of Swiggy. Earlier, customers used to walk in into our organization branches to pledge their gold and take the loan. What we started the reverse way, where our CVs go to the customer's house, okay? They take the loan, you know, get the gold there, and we disburse the loan then and there itself. Within 30 minutes at the customer's house, the loan is disbursed to customer, and my CV walks back with the gold to the branches. It's, while I said it's very simple to say, but the back end, I have my contact center solution, I have my CRM application, I have my core lending application, and I have entire digital journey mapped on the CV's mobile app. Also, the another insta gratification here we created is that at the time my CV is there at the customer's doorstep, customer can log in into my app, he can download my app, log in into that, and he can see the entire journey that is being done by the CV in his app getting replicated here, and he can see there and there is that, okay, gold is weighed, this is what this is the kind of, you know, schemes are available, I have opted for this scheme, he can see it there and there itself. So this one, which is around 70 plus APIs integrated along with five different applications, definitely helped in giving a wow to the customer. We could see now in last 1 year, it's last Diwali we introduced this, 20% of my gold loans are through this Gold Genie. We call this as a Gold Genie product. So this is a journey that we have come through in last 4 years. Definitely, we're still a lot smaller compared to what Mr. Manoj has spoken about SBI, but on this journey. Now, coming back to your, automation, hyper-automation, you said it right, you know, hyper-automation is nothing but, you know, automating the automation. And another thing which I still prefer to talk about, there's another good words coined by Fredman Thomas, you know, he says AI for IA, okay, artificial intelligence for intelligent assistance. This is what we are trying to do, provide an intelligent assistance to the individuals, customers, be it internal or external. And hyper automation is nothing but step towards that, where basically you amalgamate RPA with AI, with machine learning, and provide a better experience to your customer. Thanks, Sachin.
Yeah, thanks, Deepak. You know, very exciting. And then very happy to be, you know, Databricks is happy to be partner along with you in this your journey. I think it's very exciting time set. Obviously, it's a, as I said, I keep saying it's a journey. It never ends, actually. You just keep improving day on, actually, right, Deepak?
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah, so now let me bring Tapan into this. Tapan, you know, obviously we are from a service product like IBM Datamatics. So what's your, you know, IBM's view on whole digital transformation and, you know, what's the path, what's your point of view from IBM standpoint on overall digital transformation? Tapan, you're on mute, perhaps.
Yeah, classic technology. Thank you, Sachin. And exciting to hear a perspective coming in from the customers before we get to speak. Especially when you look at the varied, by industry, you know, from airports to banking, from a large, extremely large, super bank to somebody who just, as Deepak said, you know, a 4-year-old bank with a legacy of 8 years. Gives us a good sample size of what's going on. So let me start by saying that businesses have been adopting digital technologies for decades now. And every time there is a game-changing technological development or a material development, as we call it, we've seen this discussion around transformation coming through. So digital transformation per se, or the term, the cliche term, is not very new. It's been going on. We've lived through the internet transformation. We've lived through, we're now living through the cloud transformation, cloud-enabled transformation. And those of us who have more than gray hair, we've lived through the mainframe to distributed transformation as well. So it was technology shifts, which at a perfect time or at a time of scale, made it necessary for organizations to adopt them for the next round of value add. I think what COVID has done is simply forced forced people out of their comfort zones, where a legacy was being justified because it's always been done that way, and there is no pain or there is no pain for or a need to address it. It was brought forward. Right? Now they had no choice. If you can't go to office, you can't go to office. You have to find an alternative route. And interestingly, many customers looked at risk all over again, especially in banking environments where certain things were assumed to be regulatory, but they were not. Or there were processes built over a number of years when nobody wanted to touch because there would be element of risk. But that's gone, right? So that's one part of the story. Now, looking forward, we have been at the forefront of establishing a considered point of view around enterprise business, right? So we've always looked at what customers are trying to do with technology, what do they want to do immediately, and where are they headed? So at this point of time, our belief is that almost all customers have either embarked on the journey or seriously getting onto the journey of an AI-enabled business. That's what we hear resoundingly, that, you know, yes, there will be technology and there will be technology or technology, but ultimately, an augmentation of human effort with an intelligent system is going to be the next goal or the next milestone of developing and transformation. So that's where most companies are headed. Now, to get there, what we have adopted or what we propose is, and I heard this term, journey to AI. Journey to AI is a very IBM term. It's also a ladder to AI. So there will be steps and there'll be milestones to get to that end goal that customers plan to achieve. And this leads us into four kind of focus areas. We need to modernize anything that's legacy and has no more technological support or has better alternatives available today. We need to definitely automate at scale. We've been doing that in bits and pieces, but automate at scale and hyper-automate. To be able to predict outcomes, and that's one of the biggest changes from the past, that we were collecting data and doing some analysis on it, but really, the utopia is to get to a predictable outcome. And finally, secure everything. And I think Manojit sir talked about our competition from the scammers is very high. They probably use technology better than the customers do. But that's the point. And then at this point, IT, or people making decisions around IT, and I would use both terms, business people making technology decisions and technology people making technology decisions, have a few inflection points which will define the very architecture of what they are building in the next few years, right? So it's really important to take this into consideration. Open, hybrid, multi-cloud, that's a reality. The myth that everything is going to become public clouds or everything is going to remain hybrid or one cloud in public and everything else is hybrid, and all of those are permutation combination. The only permutation combination which will really exist and continue to exist is open, hybrid cloud. The second is the data fabric conversation. We have looked at data in many parts. We can have a complete conversation on data, but in general, what are we doing with that data? How are we collecting it? That's your gold mine. How much will you be able to get out of it as we go forward? Business automation, clearly, the levels of business automation that we can achieve, right from at the capture to act and optimize scales as we go forward. And that's on the business side. On the IT side, being able to observe your setup, you know, when all these millions of multiple parts are moving together to deliver that solution, what the end customer sees, what the business sees, is whether it's working or not, and it's working optimally or not. And for the IT teams, it becomes important to look at observability and automation of IT operations. And finally, top it all, security. So these are the five areas that is going to be of importance when it comes to architectural conversation. And we are ready today with IBM and Red Hat OpenShift. The capability that we bring is, don't worry about on-prem, off-prem, which cloud, private cloud. We can do that, right? It's lift and shift. You build an application once, it can be lifted and shifted anywhere else. You look at mitigated risks when it comes to technology combinations that you would have to look forward to. And what's your architectural finesse? How flexible is it? How will it look in the next 3 years' time or 4 years' time? And I would end with a statement I heard from one of my largest banking customers in India when I was still in India. And this was many years ago when internet was coming in. And we talked about legacy transformation. And this was the chairman of a bank who said, look, we don't have legacy. And so we're not worried about legacy. What really worries me is building a legacy. So that's where the architectural conversation really makes sense. Thanks, Sachin.
Yeah, Tapan, thank you so much. I think I like that last statement. What we're worried about is building a legacy. I think that's a good one. But I think having worked with as a partner of Databricks, being a premier partner to IBM, and having seen how IBM has refocused itself, and then leadership position that IBM has taken on a digital transformation, I think I completely agree with what you're saying just now. I think we'll look forward to working with you IBM in future as well. So now, let me bring Satyaki back here. Satyaki, we worked with you, and we've seen that phenomenal leadership that you are given to Bangalore Airport, and the way in which digital transformation has been successful, and obviously the journey continues. But what's your advice to service providers like us, like Databricks and IBM? So anything that you want to share to us?
No, I mean, I think it's a good question. I don't have an answer offhand about advice to service providers, but I think let me address it two different ways. I think the first thing is probably I will tell IBM or Databricks or any one of our partners, right? We need to spend a lot of time sitting down together to understand our challenges, our business processes, and trying to make sure that we are collectively working together to try and address the business problem. And I think in many cases, what ends up happening, at least historically, is that we end up thinking about technology as the end in itself. And I think the difference is that technology or the digital whatever we're using is a means to an end and not the end in itself. And I think unless we can link it very clearly to sort of measurable outcomes in some way, and we can say that we've either improved performance by something, or we've reduced cost by something, or we've sort of said, we've significantly changed the way the customer perceives that particular experience or goes through that process. I think the outcome is very difficult to then say that it's been a success. So I think from our perspective, we've got to sit down together with our partner, try and figure out very early on in the process what we collectively define as being the outcome we are sort of aiming for, and how that outcome will be measured in terms of saying key results or key objectives or metrics or whatever you call it, and then figure out how we get there collectively. So I think that's a key sort of principle that I would like to call out. And I think this is also something that we've learned along the way, because one of the things with digital transformation is that we are, let's say, customers, right, of services. Even we sometimes, when we start the project, right, are not sure how much data is available, how much of it is manually available. And since we're talking about hyper automation, and as you know, we're working on a process, enterprise process automation project right now. There's a lot of stuff which is still, so people are recording on paper, people are recording on an Excel sheet and things like that. And quite often we've got to make sure that we've got the data in place, the right way, the right format. It's ingestible, the data automation process works fine. And then finally, we can link it up to other platforms that we're also working on to make sure that we have the maximum benefit. And I think that's something that we have collectively do. And I think the other piece that we certainly require our partners to sit and work with us on is the cultural transformation part. I mean, I think we do a lot of it internally. And as you and I have discussed before, I think the biggest challenge to any digital transformation process is actually not the technology itself. The technology exists. I think it's the cultural transformation and sort of the organizational change that you need to make in terms of getting people to what we're doing and move away from established, or let's say historical or legacy processes that they've been following. And there's always resistance to change. Like everything else in the world. So I think that cultural transformation aspect also is quite often overlooked. And that's something that early on through the process, we've got to work together on. And I certainly think on our process automation platform, we've spent as much time on the cultural transformation as we have even on sort of architecturing and putting the technological solution here. And I think that's the other bit that I would certainly say is very, very critical to ensure the success of,
Thanks, Satik. I think what you're trying to advise to all us is basically work as one team and one voice, I think, and then work through the transformation, which is also change management. I think as a service provider, we also need to be part of that change management in your organizations. I think that's a key takeaway that I could make out. But I don't want to ask you a secret of your success, but I just want you to share some of the couple of best practices that you perhaps have adopted in your journey that our audience can get benefit from. So Satik, you may want just a couple of them. Best practices.
So I think Sachin, again, I would say that this is a 10-year journey, right? I mean, I don't think we're going to get everything right, spot on, first time. And I think we realized that early on also. So I think the first thing is that based on, and this is a personal view, not necessarily only an organizational view, but this is a personal view. But I think you need to start the vision, a clear set of ideas where you want to go. And I think that's very important. That's the first part. The second part is, I would say, start slowly and add incrementally. Because quite often what ends up happening is the technology changes. There are so many things that are also changing even from a business perspective. Something like COVID comes and a lot of priorities shift. It's not easy. I mean, and we're in the travel industry, as you know, and we've been inordinately affected by the fact that there's been very limited travel over the course of the last 18 months. And that's not something that's going to come back as quickly as, our traffic numbers, for instance, are one third of what we had pre-COVID. So I would say start incrementally and try and figure out where you're going to get most bang for your buck. Because these are all sort of also expensive platforms, big projects, and it's not something that you can sort of roll out. Right? So I would say that make sure that an outcome very clearly defined for each one of these digital initiatives that you do, and you can measure them in some way. Because I think what ends up happening is we get very excited. And there's so much good technology, there's so much excitement, but the problem is I think we end up in some ways learning to run before we can walk, or learning to sort of do a marathon before you can do a, let's say a 2-kilometer run. And I think you should start and sort of add incremental. The second thing is there will be good days and bad days, and you have to sort of assume that you're going to have that and go with that and not expect change to happen overnight. And I think finally, most critically, I would say most organizations, make sure that you take care of the change management from an organizational perspective. And I think that cultural transformation that you do when you do this digital journey is as critical or more than anything else. Because I think unless the organization buys into it significantly, and that can only come from the top. And I will say in our case, Hari, who's our CEO, and all of the management have been exceptionally committed to that transformation process. And I think that's absolutely critical, because without that level of commitment, right, that change is very difficult to bring up.
Yeah, I agree. I think, Satik, having seen your journey from close quarters, I think I've seen Hari's commitment, I've seen your commitment to the entire digital transformation at Bangalore Port. So I think I completely agree with what you said. Thank you for your views. So let me bring Monojit here. Monojit, you touched upon some of the benefits that the bank has received because of the adopted digital transformation. But then on the agility side, how a business has become agile. So is there some comments on that from your experience point of view?
Yes. So actually, success has given us two types of confidence. The first confidence is that the IT infrastructure, which can be integrated with a multiple ecosystem, and where the orchestration, the journey, superior customer experience can be given by the orchestrations at the application layer. That is the one thing, one confidence that yes, it can be done like this. And especially in a complicated IT environment, which SBI is having now, because there is, if you see the banking sector, there is no customer segment which is not serviced by SBI. There is no product which is not sold by SBI. So in this complex scenario, this, building a IT architecture like this as a foundation of, as a first confidence. Second confidence is, as I was telling, is an agile approach. which is the new, you know, culture, which is a new culture, new beginning for a bank like us. So with this confidence, I would like to touch upon, you know, four different areas that where actually we are now enjoying the agility. The first one, of course, is the customer experience. So see, traditionally, we have been telling that it is the human touch. But now the Gen Y has proved that it is the machine touch, which is more important than human touch. So that's why the digital is very important. And an organization like us who handles such a big volume, digital is, you know, indispensable, digital transformation. So that is the customer. So for the customer experience part, it's a continuous improvement, it's a continuous innovation. So we are ready for that. So now we don't see it as a challenge for us to take any new digital initiative. Okay. The second is, of course, the product and business. So till other day, our product design was based on some other concept or some other, you know, consideration. But now when we think about product, we think that how that product can be powered by data analytics. How can the product be powered or product be, you know, sold to the customer based on the customer behavior, based on the data which I have. So now that product designing is governed by these factors. Plus the implementation part, in the implementation part also it has given us, because if I launch something digitally, my monitoring, my driving, you know, analysis of customer behaviors, all these things are very easy. Okay, then the third area I want to cover is that the compliance, which is very important. Today, it is 60% compliance, 40% business for a bank. This compliance would not have been possible unless we have adopted this digital transformation. Whether it is MIS, whether it's reporting, this compliance, no, it is very important. And the last one I want to touch is the process automation. When you say process automation, it is applicable for both internal process as well as external process. All my routine process, I give an example, inward clearing check processing. So we are working on a project where, you know, this check processing, we are developing an AI model based on machine learning, based on the pattern of signature, amount in words and figure, date, so that the automated, you know, route of passing the checks can be implemented. And when we design the product, then also this come into the place. Say for example, now today when we think about, you know, digital lending, so digital lending, I have an ecosystem where all data are available in the environment. I need not to ask anything from the customer other than a few basic detail, what is your PAN number, that's all, or what is your Aadhaar number. Then I can take everything from the ecosystem. I can build an AI engine at the back end, and that AI engine will give me the customer profiling, the credit scoring, the recommendation. Then, of course, at the back end, some human will be there to take a manual decision, okay, what machine has recommended, whether I can approve it or not. So that is another new area which has given us, you know, lot of flexibility and lot of agility. And finally, you know, it is leading us in a disproportionate growth. Yes, organic growth, it has some limitation. But digital growth, if we have our platform can support the scalability, then the, you know, it supports a disproportionate growth, incremental sense beyond the traditional channel. So that is the main a few points I thought I'll highlight here.
Yeah, thank you, Manojit. I think very aptly said. I think I completely agree with what you said just now. Thanks. So Deepak, you know, question typically we also get asked sometimes, you know, and then perhaps your views would be useful here is to, you know, digital transformation, hyper automation involves some kind of investment. So what is the return on investment? How do I, you know, what's your view, views on, you know, how do you compute return on investment from this, you know, investment that we're talking about? Any experiences on this side?
Yeah, indeed, a very tricky question, actually.
You can just speak up a bit louder.
Yeah, indeed, it's a very tricky question. Reason being, Tappan and Satyajit has already, and Manojit also has already touched base upon it. Thing is, like as Satyaki said, you know, we need to look at 80-20. Which 20% of process improvement gives you 80% of the returns? You start with that. Identify those ones first and start applying them one at a time. If you go for an entire complete overall of processes, that's not going to help. And a key thing is your business processes. Realign your business's processes first, where you get the better efficiency, and then start implementing your entire automation on top of that. Once you do that, you'll see a return on investment coming quickly. But definitely, this is a journey, and definitely you can't expect a ROI immediately. But as the volumes grow, as you have the improvements in the processes, the increased TAT, improved TAT, is also one of the key parameters that you'll see. Like in our case, like we started this journey, as I mentioned, now we have implemented video PD, video KYC. Then also now we are going ahead with the AI chatbot, which is again going to improve the customer servicing, and it's basically again customer reach. So these are things, if you really look at it, they will really help you in, you know, your how are you going to calculate the ROI? One is the improved TATs, second is the increased customer satisfaction, and of course your returns on the investment. Even these two are contribute a lot to this. So it's a journey. As the volumes grow, you will benefit much better, and your ROIs will be more significantly higher in that case.
So Deepak, I think so I think but point is, are you in your journey of hyper automation, what is there some next steps that you're planning as to, you know, how do you want to mature the overall implementation? Any thoughts around that?
Yeah, we are in the early stages of hyper automation. Having said that, we already implemented robotic process automation in our organization. As part of my credit decisioning, we already have an AI taken care of there. And so that I am, helping my doing the credit decisioning faster and better, and it's more cleaner. We are comfortable with the quick decisioning, which used to be earlier a manual eyeballing. It still used to happen for few of the all the cases. Now the confidence is such a level that at least 30% of our cases go through my system, and we know that once it's approved, it's very clear cut approach. And see, another thing is here, the data is a king. With the enormous data and data story increasing, we have the decisioning is getting better. Another example I can say, where we are making use of an external agency, where for my new branches, as we are expanding our branches across India, I can identify through this data available through the external sources, which is a location where I can go ahead and set up my branch. So that level of information that's available to me. Once that is available, it's easier for me to go ahead with the expansion of branches too. That's not getting the help of the external data. As far as internal information is concerned, we have our chatbots, which we are enhancing completely. And for my internal operations team, I'm increasing my bots. I'm making the things automated in such a way that once the data is entered, people do not have to repeat it again. That's because as I said that we are just 4 years into it. I'm still finding the caveats where the things are being done manually. So we are just trying to get the whole thing done automated and see how we can, reduce these manual errors and improve the rates.
Yeah, thank you, Deepak. I think this is excellent initiative, and then I think I'm happy to see your progress, and we'll obviously work together in some your initiatives in future for sure. So let me bring Tapan here. Tapan, we've seen IBM's overall offerings to the market, and then you may want to throw some lights on your hyper automation strategies or roadmap from IBM point of view, Tapan.
Thanks, Sachin. And again, interesting point of view from cultural change, adoption to business dynamics, and how it's supporting the very story of automation. So hyper automation as a term is relatively a new term. It just got coined, I think, about less than a year ago. And the usual challenge of, and while the consultants coined this and very well thought through and very comprehensive, one of the dangers is in a situation like the pandemic created environment where customers are rushing to find a fix to certain problems, you end up with your own understanding or mini understanding, and vendors tend to come and use this jargon all the time. So in our point of view, hyper automation would be touching upon all aspects of your business that you can automate, starting from legacy that we've done. We've always captured content digitally for many, many years. We've adopted workflow for those content, again, many years ago. then you keep extending it. So again, like I did earlier, let me just set some basics. The objective at this point is to achieve a few items on the agenda for customers, which is digitize. That's the core automation. How do you digitize? How do you analyze and optimize? And how do you want to act? So I'm laying the foundation of where IBM is going with it. In terms of capabilities, we start with process mining and modeling. I mean, that's core. What do you want to do? Where do you want to get? Where you are? The whole RPA part of the story. Operational intelligence, what's really going on? How many alerts would you get? What continuous optimization can you do to your processes as they go forward? Underlying is the capture, contain decisions and workflow. And finally, we want to bring in the whole AI capability in terms of any decision making or act that you would want to go ahead with in your journey to hyper automation. Having said this, what we have done is IBM looked at, I talked it in the context of architecture, the ability to lift and shift, the ability to have a seamless offering or product which doesn't require you to do complicated yoga poses to get implemented. So we package this into what we call Cloud Packs. So Cloud Pack is nothing but a foundational layer of Red Hat OpenShift, which gives you a standardized layer. And then products from IBM built on top and packaged in a way that customers would want to utilize in a given environment. So we have Cloud Pack for automation. And this has been around since 2019, and we've been developing features into it. All our legacy offerings are now Red Hat enabled, and they are part of Cloud Pack for automation. So whether it's FileNet or it's DataCap, it's available over there. The next was the acquisitions that IBM had. We acquired WDG for RPA and MyMenu for process mining. They are part of the roadmap to be available as part of Cloud Pack for automation. We are also looking at ensuring compliance to latest standards. So when it comes to things like BPNM, we are already compliant to that, and many vendors are still trying to figure that out. No more legacy, right? So we are moving all our legacy offerings to the new cloud-enabled or cloud technology-enabled platforms. And then infusing AI at scale, the ability to have natural language processing, that opens up the entire unstructured database, data components in a customer's environment to be enabled on AI and AI to be able to work on that. So that's one whole area that opens up new with AI coming in. The other is insights. The more data you gather on your process and the way it's functioning and how can you optimize. One of the latest other offerings, Watson Orchestrate. This is like an internal assistant and of course can be used for external environments as well. But Watson Orchestrate is a key component of the automation journey forward. We also have components which are not part of Cloud Pack for data, for automation. They are part of the IBM portfolio, but Watson Assistant is another fabulous offering when it comes to building the end customer serviceability. You know, the agents that we talked about, the chatbots that we talk about, or Watson Discovery for various insights into the existing unstructured data that you have. On the Outlook, all of this to be available as a service. So we're hearing this from a lot of customers and even from our partners, that do we really want to spend so much time on implementing these solutions, or installing the solution as we would call it in the old days, or can we just use it as a service? If AI is a new electricity and I should have it on tap, then why can't I have all these capabilities going on tap? So that's on roadmap going forward. And how can you take these things as a service and consume it in your environment? Cloud Pack Foundation provides a common foundation across all Cloud Pack offerings. So whether you want to integrate a data fabric, where you're looking at security in the future, you still have a common Red Hat OpenShift oriented Cloud Pack Foundation layer, which allows all these components to come up. The last part is, as I said earlier, we are looking at automation from both angles. What I just spoke about is the business automation part. There is entire IT automation piece that comes in. So Instana for observability or is Turbonomic for asset resource management, AI ops with AI enabled decision making and trigger points. I mean, that gives a whole new fillip to the way IT is managed and how availability is given to these applications as they go forward. Because that's one of the core aspects of this whole digital journey is going to be that moment of truth when the customer is trying to use it. You know, no matter how good a solution you've built, is it available? Is it having performance degradations? When you try and upgrade, and with mobile technology, the upgrades are probably monthly, if not lesser than that. You know, is everything working fine? Or I used to have the problem. I had to reinstall a bank's application every time we went through a version upgrade. So all of those are experiences that will be at some point touched upon by the automation discussion that you're having in your organization. So that's our roadmap going forward, and that's our position today.
Thank you, Tapan. I think very, very well said. I think good articulation of what the plan from IBM side. I think very happy to hear that. So I think let me just summarize then, you know, in one line, actually what we have heard from all of you is, you know, both digital transformation and hyper automation, which obviously hyper automation enables or helps you through digital transformation. So in three words, keywords, I can talk about: one is experience, then efficiency, and then expense. So digital transformation helps you to increase the efficiency, increase the experience, and decrease the expense. So I think this in one line, if I have to summarize, these are the three keywords I could hear from get from all of you. So thank you so much. I think we just have 5 minutes, so we can take a couple of questions. So Dimple, are there questions from the
yes,
audience we
hi.
Can take?
Sachin, yes, we have one question that says, what is the product design life cycle and product assessment to delivery? Please share all steps.
So Tapan, you want to take that question, please?
Yeah. Okay. Let me try and understand the question. Is it product? What is the project design life cycle? Was that in context of a customer building their end application, or was it in the context of IBM providing a solution?
That has not been specified, Mahesh. If you could specify on that, we could take up that question. Okay, until then, we will take another question. It says, what has been the topmost impeding factor in your journey?
Dimple, the question was, topmost what?
Topmost impeding factor in your journey. And yeah. And we have another question that says, how do you define digital?
So topmost impeding factors, I think a better person to answer this is Sapteki, because I think he has overcome a lot of impediments in the journey, because I have seen that personally. So Sapteki, maybe you just want to answer this question.
I'm ending up sounding as if I've been cynical about this. No, I think yeah. I mean, there are always impediments in any journey. I think, as I said, I think the biggest issue is that resistance to change. You know, most people are quite happy in general with status quo. And I think, as I said, first, there were two key points, I think, from our perspective. One is making sure we can scope something out correctly. And as I think, you know, Deepak or I can't remember, Manojit, one of them said, try and get maximum bang for your buck, right? In terms of trying to scope it out such that you can get 80% of the outcome potentially with 20-30% of that key, whatever you're doing initially. The second thing is that whole concept of return on investment, especially with something like digital, which is very difficult to define. And, you know, having a clear vision of what you would consider an outcome. And even if it's not exactly tangible every time, because there are both tangible and intangible elements to that transformation journey, having a clear idea of that outcome and what you would constitute as success. And thirdly, that cultural transformation, like I said, which is much, much more important than people realize, of doing that cultural transformation early on and very seriously within the organization to make sure that the organization buys into that transformation journey. And I think to me, those are the three key steps from our perspective.
Yeah, thanks. I think a good answer. Thank you, Sapteki. So Dimple, what was the next question? I could not catch that actually.
Yes, it says, how do you define digital?
How do you define digital? Yes. So maybe Manojit, you just may want to address that part.
Yes. So as I said, no, if you ask me in a single line, no, then converting human touch into machine touch is the digital.
You want to touch into yeah, okay. Good one. Yeah, thanks, Manojit. So Dimple, I think the questions got answered.
Yes.
Anything else?
We have some couple of more questions, although we won't be able to take all of them. We'll try to take one or two more. What is the criteria for partner selection when it comes to digital transformation?
What is the criteria for? Ask this.
Partner selection when it comes to digital transformation.
Yeah. So Deepak, maybe just, I think you're the ideal person to answer this.
So first you understand what you want to do, what are the areas that you want to do the transformation, identify your processes. Once you identified your process that you want to do the transformation in that area, then identify the partners who have done the work in that area. That's very important for you. And the kind of expertise that partners has and what kind of a work that is done in that area, which is the key thing. The experience of the partner matters a lot here, and the experience and the experienced team that comes along with that partner. So once you are defined those clearly and what you are looking at from this project, it's very easy for you to go ahead and take a look at these partners, evaluate the partners basis this criteria, and choose the best one that you think at that point in time and go ahead with that partner.
Very nicely put forward, Deepak. I think good. I like that answer. Thank you, Deepak. So, Dimple, any more questions? We just at the end of what's
depleted time. Could just take one more question. I'll let go of the others. One last question is, according to you, what role executive management plays in the digitization journey?
What role executive management plays in an digital journey?
Digitization
again,
journey.
I think having, again, Satyaki, I think, I wouldn't resist to pass this question to you. I think you are the best to answer this.
I think it's, as I said before, Sachin, I think it's imperative for executive management to sort of buy completely into that transformation journey, because as I said earlier on the panel, it has to come from the top. Unless you buy into that transformation completely, and unless it's driven from the top. Right, it's very difficult to effect that change.
I agree.
And I think, I really couldn't stress how important it is. I think it's very, very crucial. And I think almost a success or failure of a program, especially the more complex it is incumbent on executive management to sort of drive it.
Yeah, I agree. Because I've seen how Hari drives it himself. He's a very ardent user of technology. So I couldn't agree more. Thank you, Satyaki. So Dimple, I think we're done with the question answer. So any back to you, Deepak, Dimple.
Thank you, Sachin. Thank you so much for taking us through such an enlightening and such a perspective session. It was an absolute pleasure to listen to such a fantastic discussion today. And I'm confident that everyone in the audience has gained some really valuable insights from today's discussion. Before we conclude, I'd like to express my gratitude to every one of our panelists for making the time to join us here today and sharing their knowledge and their expertise with us. Thank you once again for joining this session on Enhancing Business Operations with Hyper-Automation Enabled Digital Transformation Powered by Datamatics and IBM Partner. We look forward to seeing you all more for our webinars and our discussions in the future. This is Dimple Bajwa signing off. Have a nice day, everyone, and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.